Welcome. In a previous lecture, you have learned about the seismic assessment process of existing buildings. In this lecture, we'll have a look at the conventional structural upgrading of masonry buildings. There are different aims in the structural upgrading of existing masonry buildings. First of all, the aim is to reduce the risk of collapse and partial collapse. Secondly, the aim is to reduce the risk of external and internal falling hazards. To do this, structural upgrading measures are used. Normally, these are divided into two categories. First, we have the conventional methods, and secondly, we have the new technologies, such as base isolation and energy dissipative systems. In this lecture, we will focus on the conventional upgrading measures. The structural upgrading measures are aimed at meeting the target performance levels discussed in the previous lectures. The following criteria are important when you need to choose between different structural upgrading alternatives. Most important, the chosen option should provide a correction of the observed deficiencies. Where possible, the chosen option should not increase weight and not change how the building is experienced. The chosen option should be able to be integrated in the current architectural intent and style. Of course, the designer should be able to provide assurance that it can successfully design and detail the chosen option to the applicable codes. And general or specialist contractors should be able to execute the chosen option. But last but not least, the cost should be taken into account. In order to reduce the risk of collapse or partial collapse, three types of measures are taken. The first type is to reduce the weight of elements, the roof, the floors and the walls. The second type is to improve the box behavior of the building. The third type is improving the capacity of structural elements. In order to reduce the risk of internal and external falling hazard, four types of measures are taken. First type is to eliminate the elements by taking it off. The second type is replacing the element. The third type is supporting the element, preventing it from falling. And the last type is to strengthen the element so that it will not fall. Let's have a closer look at some of these factors. First, I will discuss reducing the weight of the elements. Then we will consider how to improve the box behavior of the building, followed by how to strengthen the structural elements. Reducing the weight of the elements without affecting the capacity of elements can be done by removing elements and replacing them with lightweight versions. Examples of this are heavy roof coverings or external cavity walls. Or, as shown here, if replacing a heavy chimney with a lightweight version. There are two measures to improve the box behavior, which should be used in combination. The first measure is to use positive connections to connect the elements, such as the floors, the roofs, and the walls, with positive connections. The second measure is to improve the rigidity of the floors and roofs, so that the seismic forces will load the walls in plane and not out of plane, which is prone to damage and collapse. In order to make positive connections between the wall and the floor, anchors are commonly used. There are different anchor solutions depending on the wall configurations and the floor types. Cavity walls pose a specific challenge and novel solutions are being developed. Anchors can also be used to make a positive connection between the wall and the roof. There are different anchor solutions depending on the wall configuration and the roof structure typologies. Improving the rigidity of the timber floors can be done in several ways. The first possible method is adding steel strips with nails. Another method is adding sheets of fiber-reinforced polymer. Maybe the most simple method is adding timber plate with nails. If the top of the floor is not accessible, timber plates can be added to the bottom of the floor. Another suitable method at the bottom of the floor is to add steel timber bracings. Two methods can be used to improve the rigidity of the timber roof. The first method is to add a timber-plated structure on the inside of the roof. The second method is to add steel bracings. There are several methods to improve the in-plane and out-of-plane capacity of elements as shown in this overview. Method 1 is to give support. Method 2 is improving the structure. Method 3 is adding additional structure. There are many ways to achieve this, and the applications depend on the knowledge and experience of the building industry. Giving support is the most simple method to improve capacity. In many cases, giving support are temporary measures. The existing structure can also be improved by increasing the capacity of the walls. The following three measures are often used. The first method is to add strips of fiber-reinforced polymer on the wall. An alternative method is to add steel reinforcement in the wall. A third method is to add steel reinforcement on top of the wall in combination with shotcrete. The last option has more capacity and is very easy to execute, but puts significant new loads on the existing structure. Another way of increasing the capacity of the walls is to add additional structures. The following three measures are often used. The first is to add timber-plated structure, which are easy to install. Slightly more difficult to install, but with higher capacity, are to add steel brace structure and to add steel portal structures. The members of the portal frame are bigger than the braced frame and give more flexibility for voids such as doors and windows. Some external falling hazards have been identified for the Dutch building stock, such as chimneys, parapets, gables, canopies, dormers, cavity wall, glass areas and signs. There are also internal falling hazards, such as non-structural walls, stairs, furniture, such as bookcases and cupboards, and of course heavy objects. There are four ways to reduce the risk caused by falling hazard. The first method is elimination, taking the falling hazard off and not replacing it. An alternative method is to replace the falling hazard with an element that will not fall. The falling hazard could also be supported so that it will not fall. This is normally done by creating one or more additional support points. Or it can be strengthened by adding material on the inside or outside of the element, making the element stronger. Last but not least, we should mention to avoid interior elements from falling during an earthquake, such as walls or furniture. They should be fixed to the structure. So, now we have reached the end of the lectures. We had a look at different conventional upgrading measures for masonry buildings. The solutions that I discussed are the most basic measures, and the total solution is of course a combination of those measures and will result in different alternatives. Selection criteria are used to choose the best alternative. We must take into account that the more complex situations, the upgrading measures are most likely to be different. Thank you.